to win. The water's as high as the time to win. So I jump back in and where I learned to swim. Try to keep my head above it the best I can. That's why here I am, just waiting for this storm to pass me by. And that's the sound of sunshine coming down.
Why don't you folks come in and take their seats, please? We're going to start session number 8. This is the so-called Houdini session, named after Harry Houdini. Or how am I going to get out of this one? We've got 7 speakers, which means our question and answer session at the end is limited to 15 minutes. So when you submit questions, submit your very best question. Please don't submit 5, 6, 7. We're not going to have time for them at the end. First speaker up, you already are familiar with, Dr. Matt Martin, formerly chief of trauma and research at Madigan, now in San Diego. He's going to talk to us about the mediastinal traverse. Matt.
All right. Okay, we got the slides up. And good morning, everyone. Great to see everyone here this early in Vegas. I'm going to be talking about transmediastinal trauma. And as you see, we'll have a kind of a jungle theme. I have no financial conflicts. I just retired from the Army, so if there's any reps back there, I'm interested in developing some. These are my opinions. I'm not a thoracic surgeon, and there is very little data on this topic, so a lot of this is really expert opinion. It's important to realize most thoracic trauma does not require an urgent operative intervention. You can see they're only about 3% overall, but when we're talking about mediastinal injuries, you can see 100% of unstable patients, and even in the stable patients, about 50% require some kind of urgent surgical intervention. So this is a very special subcategory. And if we're talking about our injury mechanisms, generally transmediastinal is not going to be a stab wound. And, you know, somebody here, although they did a good transmediastinal stab wound, but this is America. We love our guns, right? And so almost all of these mechanisms are going to be gunshot wounds. This is a nice older study, but what it showed is most of the time you can pick up the major injuries just by chest x-ray and physical exam. If you have a systolic above 100, 60% don't need an operation, but if you have a systolic less than 60, all need an operation. And then if you're in that mid-range, still 50% need or don't need, however you want to look at it. So the message there is if you're unstable, that you need to operate. But even the stable group, still 50 to 60% of patients are going to need an operation. And your goal should be trying to not make your operation an ED thoracotomy, right? This is actually after they've pronounced the patient. And you know what he's thinking. He's looking at, I wish I was doing this in the OR. This is miserable. This guy's thinking, finally, I can see something in that deep, dark hole where you couldn't see anything. This guy's questioning his decision to come to the ER. for that arm laceration. So we talked a little bit about direct to OR yesterday, and these are ideal cases for that. And where I worked in Portland, these patients would go direct to the OR. That doesn't mean you're operating on them. You're doing everything you do in the trauma bay. It's just you're in the OR, and if you need to operate, you are there and you can get started. So we'll talk about the mediastinal jungle, and this is a target-rich environment for hitting bad things. And we often train our residents to, when you hear hoofbeats, think of horses, not zebras. Think of common things first and then uncommon things, but don't forget, you know, when you hear purring or when you hear nothing for this area, think of tigers. And those are the things that'll kill you. So I tell them, things that'll kill you first, then things that are common, then the zebras. And what's going to kill you? So the tigers are these. And most of them are massive bleeding. So heart, great vessels, tension hemothorax, airway, major airway issues where you can't oxygenate and ventilate, and esophagus with asterisks there. Esophagus won't kill you initially, but if you've missed it within 24 to 48 hours, they'll usually be dying. Then the common things, what are most common, actually not even in the mediastinum, but lung lacerations and hemopneumothoraces are going to be your most common. Then injuries to the heart, because it's the biggest structure in the mediastinum, diaphragm, and spine. And then the uncommon things. Fortunately, esophagus is uncommon because of how small it is. The azygos system, the thoracic duct, and air embolism. And I approach them in that order. And then the next question is, you know, how do you want to be shot and what do you worry about? And we see, if we see a trajectory like this, we automatically think transmediastinal, and you know, our faces kind of do that. But this is actually the one I fear much more, the anterior, posterior, or vice versa wound, because that one can go across all four anatomic compartments of the mediastinum, whereas the side-to-side usually only goes through one. And every talk on the mediastinum has this slide where you start listing off all the structures that are in each compartment, and the audience starts to do something like this. It's not real important other than having some basic concepts, which are this. Patients don't get shot in the anatomic position, right? Our patients are running, ducking, hiding. They're prone, they're supine. So the bullet may not take a straight track. And then the other thing is, if you move your anatomic position, so if I lean forward, or if I'm prone, like Dr. Brown last night at the bar, your heart is now an anterior mediastinal structure. So the only thing to know about your compartments is there's some pretty important things there. There's nothing in the anterior, and then it's really your heart, your esophagus, your great vessels, your aorta. The other thing is medical illustrators, and I'll add acid instructors are the ultimate optimists. Right? It never looks like this when you open it up. This is what you're looking at. So it's real important to understand the key anatomy, because it's never going to be as clear as it is in the books or a cadaver dissection. So how do we manage these patients? Well, the first 5 minutes, unstable patient goes to the OR, like this patient with a massive hemothorax. That's very simple. These are life-threatening injuries. If you're taking them to the OR emergently, don't do this. Lateral D-cube is not a position for an exploratory trauma operation where you don't know exactly what you're dealing with. Right? So thumbs down for lateral D-cube. This is what you want to do. Supine always for exploratory surgery. Whether you do a median sternotomy, thoracotomy, extended to a clamshell, you can go up into the neck if you need to get high. You can go into the belly if you need to get lower. You can do periclavicular or trapdoor incisions. So preserve your options unless you absolutely know what the injury is and you're not dealing with anything else. And those rare times are when you have the known isolated injury and they're stable and have no other problems. And so if you have an isolated esophagus, a posterior lateral thoracotomy, either right or left, depending on where the esophagus is injured, if you really have skills, you can do this with a VATS or transhiatal or laparoscopic approach. Descending aorta, a left posterior lateral thoracotomy is your incision of choice. And then distal trachea or bronchi, again, posterior lateral thoracotomy on which side, depending on which side the injury is. Anything else, you should, again, keep the patient supine and preserve your options. So we'll talk about a case, and this is actually one we had a couple months ago at Scripps. Shot in the left chest, having left chest pain, he's paraplegic on exam. Blood pressure looks okay, sats are okay. Here's the gunshot wound, single gunshot wound there, so we can assume entry. So first, what info do I have? Well, we know there's an injury in the chest. We know he's paraplegic, so I know it at least went to the midline and went through the spine somewhere. What info do I need? Well, I need to know, is there life-threatening thoracic injury, and where's the bullet would be nice to know, right? And so that's a chest x-ray. Upright or reverse T position increases the yield. You can see that fragment is in the right upper chest. So that was probably a transmediastinal or suspected transmediastinal path. And then the FAST exam is important, mainly the pericardial view. You want to know, you know, immediately, do you have a heart injury with pericardial fluid? So again, that's the gunshot wound. We now know it went that way. We now have a suspected transmediastinal injury. So a left chest tube was placed, got about a liter and a half out, but then nothing, and the patient remained perfectly stable. He's alert and mentating. So the question is, what do we do next? And some people would say 1,500 cc's, they'd go to the OR for that, but he's stable now, he's fine, he's not bleeding anymore from the chest. So how do we work up this transmediastinal injury for the stable patient? And this is what we used to do. I call this the full meal deal, right? We'd investigate every structure in that mediastinum, and that would mean all these studies. So so you're taking the patient all over the hospital, angiography, you're going to endoscopy, or an esophageal swallow, you're doing a pericardial window. So you can imagine this takes hours, and you're bringing the patient all over the place. Well, the nice thing now is there's a simple answer. It's a CAT scan. So a high-quality CT angiogram of the chest gives you all of your initial information that you need, and this is actually the CAT scan of that patient. You can see he's still got some blood on the left side. Again, that's our estimated trajectory, which you can now get a very nice detailed view with that chest CT. So I'm just going to quickly talk about how I approach looking at the CT scans for these types of injuries and the rules. First is trust no one, right? The Taliban is everywhere, especially in radiology. So... so So this is not the one where you want to have the resident tell you, yeah, we looked at the CAT scan and here's what it found. This is one where you want to sit down at the terminal, scroll down through that x-ray. If you can review it with a radiologist, that's even better. I run through it once, looking for the major injuries. I then run through it again, looking to reconstruct the tract and see where that bullet went, and then I know a little bit more about what I need to worry about. And then you can do additional studies as needed by your review of that CAT scan. And I'll just show you a quick video of doing this. So here I'm running through looking for injuries. You can see we've got that left hemothorax and left lung injury, as expected. The heart looks okay. Don't see any other major concerning injuries. We saw the bullet fragment was up in the right. Now I'm going back up, and now I'm starting to reconstruct that tract. Okay, so there's the bullet where it ended up. I'm following the track back where it went through the spinal canal. And then I'm following the trajectory back through to the entry site. Now I have my estimated trajectory, you know, and bullets don't take a straight path, but they can't make magical turns, right? So, and then now I'm looking at the key mediastinal structures, trachea, aorta, esophagus. Do I see any air around it? Do I see any wall irregularities? Is there any extravasation of contrast? And now I have a very good picture of what I'm worried about. And there's the trajectory. So does this patient need any additional workup other than the chest tube? Probably not. How about this patient though? You've got all that air, that's the trajectory that you just estimated for your transmediastinal wound. That's a patient who probably needs at least their esophagus evaluated, needs something looking at the heart, and the aorta, you can get a pretty good shot of the aorta on the CT. Probably doesn't need anything else done for that. And so this is a nice algorithm that just emphasizes that. We're a stable patient, you do the CTA chest, and that's your study for guiding everything else. If you have a possible esophageal injury, you look at that. Airway injury, you do a bronch. Possible vascular injury, you can do an angiogram. And I'll add one more thing to this. If there's a concern about the heart, you want to do an echo or a pericardial window. If you have one of those, well, there's equivocal fluid. And this has now been validated in only a couple studies, because that's all there are, but they've shown that a CT scan versus a CT plus doing all those extra studies has the same yield. And in fact, no missed injuries, at least in the couple published studies. So CTA is a very reliable initial screening study for these patients. I'm gonna real briefly talk about some technical tips. If you get into the techniques of managing all those mediastinal structures, that's another couple hour lecture. One thing is, and definitely when we go direct to the OR, our incision of choice, at least in Portland, was a median sternotomy. And one thing you'll see here is you've got great exposure to the heart, the great vessels, but you'll commonly hear a misperception that, well, you can't get into either chest or do anything for lung injury. Well, those two structures partially covering the heart or the lungs, so you can see we're in both chest cavities, and if you put a hand over that lung and retract it, you're now looking completely into that chest cavity. If there's a real posterior injury, not great exposure for that, but great exposure for doing most of what you need to do emergently for these injuries. And odds are this is usually gonna be your best exposure. The other thing to remember is there's a couple key gateway vessels, and for the great vessels, you can see the innominate artery there, the internal mammary arteries above. You can see that big blue vein running across, that's the innominate vein. That's your gateway to those vessels. If you have a great vessel injury, you usually have to get that out of the way. You can ligate that and divide that with impunity. Don't worry about it. Just divide it, get it out of the way, and now you're looking at the aortic arch and the great vessels. And then finally, repair of the trachea or bronchus if you have an injury there. And this is probably one of the least common things we do and are comfortable with, and this is just showing you want to mobilize it, get enough length to bring it together if you can. Usually absorbable suture, interrupted, I think is better than running. Taking the tracheal ring above and below, and you can see here that's just a simple interrupted repair. One thing to avoid, you'll hear a lot of people talk about, well, I see a hole, I'll just put a tracheostomy tube in it. So that's one thing I would recommend avoiding. If you can do a good primary repair, that's better than doing a tracheostomy. And then the other thing you'll hear is, I want to leave them intubated and put the ET tube distal to this. Actually, these patients, you want to extubate them. You want to be really aggressive and try and extubate them if you've done a tracheal repair. You'll have a much better chance of that healing well versus keeping them intubated. And then always cover these repairs, esophagus, trachea, bronchus. intercostal muscle flap or a pleural flap looks good, but again, you want to assume this is going to break down. You want to assume it's going to erode into something next to it and cause a big problem. So I'll finish with, again, the most important slide of the talk. If you see a multiple choice question in your near future, the most likely injury with a transmediastinal gunshot wound is actually not a mediastinal structure. It's always going to be a lung parenchymal injury. And then the diagnostic study of choice, I hope everybody gets this right from what I've just talked about, is a chest CT scan in a stable patient with a transmediastinal injury. So I want to thank you all. It's been another great year of the Maddox meeting, and I look forward to the panel.
If you want copies of those video clips, see Dr. Martin after the session. The next speaker is Miguel Cubanos, Chief Commanding Officer at Naval Medical Health Clinic in Corpus Christi. He's going to talk to us about something we hope we never see, in giant gastric ulcer.
Thank you very much. I really hate to go after Martin all the time, I tell you. So good morning. Where's the clicker? Okay, good. Yes, you got it. All right. Thank you, Dr. Mattox, the committee, Mary Ellen. This is not clicking right here. All right, I have nothing to disclose. So what now? That's the big question. So by the time I'm done, in the next 14 minutes, I hope that that answer comes very clearly and you don't end up looking like Mr. Beam here. But I tell you, that was supposed to get more laughs, but after Martin, I mean, that's a... what can I do? So let's frame the talk very quickly. The introduction: surgery is no longer, as we all know, the primary treatment for peptic ulcer disease, thanks to the discovery of the role of Helicobacter pylori, and basically PPIs, right, has decreased the need for vagotomy in a lot of these patients. Gastric ulcers, by definition, are 3 centimeters or larger, and they are 20% of the 100,000 ulcers that we see diagnosed every year in the United States. All right, general concepts. We're gonna talk about the type of interventions that we're gonna have, basically gastric outlet, intractable ulcer, obviously after proper medical treatment, bleeding ulcer, and the dreaded perforation, which is only 1.5, but as you all know, it's a very stickler. Conclusions and some executive summary. All right, little anatomy. Mainly a lot of these ulcers and the lesser curvature around the incisor angularis. The sites of the three types of vagotomy we do, two of them require drainage, obviously the truncal and the selective required some kind of drainage, and the highly selective, which is not used anymore. And a lot of these vagotomies right now with the PPI will not be used. The main reason to use vagotomies in this day and age in a way is people that cannot afford it. A lot of the countries outside the United States are still using vagotomy because they want to do the acid reduction. So historical, and we'll have that. Modified Johnson classification, mainly the type 1, which is 55%. That's the majority of the ulcers that we see. Type 2, it's pre-pyloric. The type 2 is the 25%, and the pre-pyloric. A big thing is that, remember, the type 1 has no acid, and as well as the 4. 2 and 3 tend to have acid related to their ulcer, and it's important because that's on the patients that you would use the PPI or would use a vagotomy. All right, so very quickly, this is a big problem worldwide. 87 million people were diagnosed with ulcers in 2015, and the main etiologies are NSAIDs and Helicobacter pylori, as we know. And this is not new. Mr. Iceman, 3,000 years before BCE, had H. pylori. By the way, that's not what killed him. It was an arrow, anyway. So introduction, very quickly. That's in your syllabus. You need to diagnose other reasons for having these ulcers. Diagnosed by a urea breast test is probably the easiest one. But the sensitivity and the specificity are around in the 90s in all of them. So quickly, main treatment, if you see this giant gastric ulcer other than perforation and bleeding, this patient, you need to treat the HPI, you need to know the status and the history and physical, reduce, stop the NSAIDs, change it to a COX-2, you can do that too, or give the antacids to this patient. Already have in the book the triple quadruple therapy, it has to be 14 days, and you need to test those patients afterwards. One little caveat, when you have confirmation of eradication on using the urea breath test, you need to have those patients on off PPI for 2 weeks. If not, it's going to give you a false negative. Optimize all patients, basically EGD. If in the military, we still do the EGDs. I know in the civilian world, if you do an EGD yourself or a colonoscopy, you don't get a referral from gastroenterologist, but we still do it. Main thing is be there, be present. There's a lot of characteristics of that ulcer that will help you decide what you're going to do. All settings, if you're going to operate or non-operate, always treat HPI. And big thing, biopsies, at least 8, right? PPI, like I already talked, is really substituting a lot of the situations with vagotomy. Big thing, always take biopsies, like I said, 8, and even in the OR, frozen section. We're going to talk a little bit about that dreaded perforation with that positive biopsy coming back as malignant. But one of the things that if biopsy is malignant will require eventually total gastrectomy, subtotal gastrectomy, that's the standards. And we're going to talk about D1, D2 very quickly if the patient is stable. One of the things right in the panel says, hey, I have a patient with a pressure of 80, whatever, or 90, and had these things. What would you do with the ascites, et cetera? Well, stable, it's in the mind of the beholder. So basically, whatever definition, your capabilities in AICU, your own skills. So that's really what you need to put into the equation when you're deciding what to do. Be a gram patch, for example, or you're going to do a distal gastrectomy on a perforation. That will be up to you. I'll give you what the data will shows right now. So giant gastric ulcer, already said 20%. Most of the complication is bleeding. Perforates in 1.5. 30% harbor malignancy, and red is the answer. Red is the answer. Perforated ulcers, more than obstructing ulcer, may harbor malignancy. Majority are adenocarcinomas, 90%. Goblet obstruction, 37 are benign. A lot of the peripancreatic cancer, and this is what the patients usually do. Remember to replace the sodium chloride before the potassium. NG tube might not be big enough. You might have to do an EGD to get some of the content out before you operate on these patients. CT with oral contrast to get an idea of how tight they are. Always, if it's related to a gastric outlet source, giant gastric ulcer, is rule out malignancy until proven otherwise. All right, benign, you give him 48 to 72 hours of IV, PPI, and treat him, check for HPI. If it's chronic, it's a different story. You still give him medical treatment, but surgery most likely. And these patients will do well, the benign ones, on dilation, 76% success. A lot of these patients will end up with a vagotomy and trectomy and a Billroth 1 or 2 reconstruction. By the way, you can do laparoscopic or open, it's your preference. The intractable, basically, they don't heal after 12 weeks of proper treatment. It has to have 2 HPI methods to check it. Always rule out the Solinger-Ellison, either gastrin levels, secretin levels, it's all that important. It's all in the thing that I gave you, the pamphlet. And those patients, if it's positive for malignancy, again, we talked about that D1 or D2 notes. Very quickly, we're going to get there. These are the different surgical approaches of choice. And D1, D2, the Japanese Society for Research in Gastric Cancer gave us the standards, D1, D2 on these patients, and in their studies, they claimed there's increased survival, lower recurrence, et cetera. D2 comprises of distal pancreatectomy and splenectomy. The British and the Dutch tried to reproduce that, and they saw that the mortality was higher. I mean, and they went and did their own prospective study, and they found that the patient's recurrence and survival was increased by not doing the distal pancreatectomy and the splenectomy. So that's kind of the standard. A lot of people, they haven't been able to reproduce the Japanese numbers. All right, bleeding, 40%. Basically, 75 stop with IV and PPI, and 95% will stop with interventional radiologist and the gastroenterologist doing all their tricks, right? Embolization and all the other cauterization. If you need to go to the OR, basically you oversaw those alone, oversawing with vagotomy and drainage, all that is acceptable. Some of these patients might end up having vagotomy and antrectomy, or distal gastrectomy, but recent studies show they're talking about oversawing with vagotomy and drainage to be the lowest mortality. The dreaded perforation, basically, thank God, it's only 1.5%. This is the second answer to the second questions you probably have. The contained, we still use, there's a non-medical treatment of perforation. The limit, the age group on many of the studies I read was 70. The Japanese, they used the following. They said basically a patient that is stable with not severe comorbidities, no ascites, and the peritoneal irritation very localized or on the upper abdomen. And those are the criteria they use. There's a big study of 183 patients, multi-institutional, done in Niigata, Japan. They treated 57 patients and non-operative like this, and they ended up converting 16 of them. So, and then the ones that were taken to the operating room, basically a non-operative or minimal surgery was basically closure and gram patch, right? And the other half of those patients, of the 91 remaining, were also done with distal gastrectomy or vagotomy and antrectomy, and they did not see a difference in complications. All right, we talked about this, distal gastrectomy, Billroad 1, 2. Type 2 and 3, remember this is a giant gastric ulcer with a duodenal ulcer. The algorithm just basically talking about wedge in the right side. I know you can't see it very well, but the bottom line is I don't want to, if you have a truly giant gastric ulcer, a wedge might not work. So in those cases, you either patch or you will just do a distal gastrectomy. This gram patch was done in Afghanistan. Dr. Strite from the Air Force did a fantastic job on one of those monsters. And in conclusion, these ulcers have a higher chance of bleeding, perforating, intractability. They're dreaded. Malignant during EGD, at the time, always, if you remember anything from this lecture, biopsy, 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 frozen sections. And the other thing is, gram patch is not one size fits all, right? You have to have in back of your mind that you might need to do a distal gastrectomy. There's studies that show that those patients do better. A lot of the primary closure in these ulcers will tend to have a fistula. So, all those are in my references. All right, if the perforation is positive, those patients, you might just treat them with ECF. You know, the MAGIC trial talks about it. If you see an ulcer in an intractable patient and it turns out to be positive, you will give them neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Again, ECG, eritubricin, cisplatin, and 5-FU is what the treatment of choice. So it's not the end of the world if you do a frozen section and it comes back positive, and you're in there, and the patient severely is unstable in your standards. You patch them, and you go ahead and treat them later. Treat them with chemotherapy. Some of them will get chemo radiation, and then you bring them back 3 to 6 months and complete the D1 and complete the operation, total gastrectomy, etc. We already talked about this bleeding ulcer, oversawing. The majority stops by the gastroenterology and the radiologist. Those Taliban guys, you know, that Dr. Martin mentioned, the Taliban, the ISIS. Anyway, the last one, obstruction, again, gastroglottal obstruction. If it's malignant and you cannot operate, those patients will receive a stent. And the perforation, I think we went over in all these different options. Like I told you, the wedge, I am not too fond of that. If you are going to try to wedge, your defect will be so large, it'll be very difficult to close. Drains and feeding jejunostomy, I do them as needed on those patients. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Next speaker, Dr. David Notrico, who's the Trauma Medical Director at Phoenix Children's Hospital, is going to speak to us about caustic burns of the upper GI tract.
Thank you. I greatly appreciate the honor of the invitation to speak at this conference. I have no financial disclosures, but I do have a conflict of interest, and that is that I chair three other trauma critical care conferences, two of which Dr. Maddox has been the keynote speaker at. I'm going to be talking about two different groups of patients today when we talk about caustic ingestions, the pediatric patients and the adult patients. And we'll also talk about different types of agents. So children age 2 to 6 make up the vast majority of patients who have caustic ingestions, and they accidentally ingest cleaning agents. They usually have mild injuries. By contrast, the smaller number of adult patients, 30 to 60 attempting self-harm, are the ones who are most likely to die from their ingestions. And these are often strong corrosives, and they're often severe life-threatening injuries. Alkali ingestions are the most common in the United States, and they actually cause liquefaction necrosis, whereas acids cause coagulation necrosis. The reason that you want to know that is because coagulation necrosis initially limits the penetration of the substance into the esophagus and decreases the damage. But once it gets to the stomach, it causes pyloraspasm, and then it sits in the stomach for a longer period of time. So there's prolonged contact with the mucosa, and that results in extensive gastric damage from acid injuries. Oxidants such as bleach are generally mild injuries. They transform amino acids, and they denature proteins. And then ammonia causes a superficial hemorrhagic gastritis. But that injury can continue for 24 to 48 hours after injury, so you need to be aware of that. Risks of injury, certainly the pH of the substance matters, and the quantity that the patient ingested is a huge factor. The concentration of the stuff, just because you know the pH doesn't mean that you know the concentration, and then the length of time that the substance was in contact with the mucosa makes a difference as well. Alkaline substances tend to be less offensive to our taste compared to acids, and there's generally a greater opportunity to swallow more, especially for accidental ingestions. So they have a higher risk of serious injury. Symptoms are an issue. They're a bit of a problem in the sense that their symptoms or the lack of symptoms are not accurate predictors of the caustic ingestion, nor are they accurate predictors of damage. And neither is looking at the mucosa. So if you look at the mouth mucosa, you don't know whether or not they actually got it into their esophagus or into their stomach. But an increased number of symptoms actually does correlate with the significance of the injury. The thing that we worry about often in kids is airway, but airway compromise in children is very uncommon. Adults, however, are at increased risk of laryngeal or airway swelling, and if they have that, that's a really bad thing. They tend to have more significant injuries if they have airway compromise, and it's just a prognostically a bad marker. Additional symptoms may result from the perforation, so if these, if they're in contact or strong enough, they'll actually cause perforation. What children present with when they perforate is often irritability as their first presenting sign. They can have fever, tachycardia, and hypotension. They come a little bit later. Endoscopy. So endoscopy certainly is the mainstay in pediatric ingestions, and we do endoscopy because we want to know the extent, location, and the severity of the injury. And generally in children, the endoscopy is done around 12 to 24 hours after the ingestion. Now, the reason we do endoscopy in children is because these are accidental ingestions, and we don't really know whether or not they ingested it or what the severity is. If you do it before 12 hours, a lot of times there's not enough mucosal injury to tell whether or not they have significant damage. And then after 48 hours, some clinicians feel that there's an increased risk of perforation, but that's not proven. And recently, there's actually been a study that showed that you can do endoscopies even after 48 hours safely. In children with signs of mediastinal infection, they need an evaluation prior to endoscopy. So they need either a chest X-ray followed by a water-soluble esophagram, or what we prefer is a CT scan with water-soluble contrast. The drool score is good to know on a population basis. It basically assigns points for symptoms such as drooling, reluctance to eat, oropharyngeal burns, or the kind of other category, which is fever, hemoptysis, hematemesis, et cetera, and then leukocytosis. What we generally use in clinical practice is the Zarger classification. And this is an endoscopic grading system where the burns are graded from 0 to 3. 0 is no damage, and 3B is extensive necrosis. This table is in the syllabus if you want to refer to it, but basically it's an endoscopic grading scale. So the grade 2s have ulcerations, whereas the grade 3s have actual necrosis. This works well in the accidental injuries because they tend to be less severe, whereas suicide attempts are more on the high grade. And the real limitation of the Zarger system is that it gives a good idea of the extent of the injury, but not of the depth of the injury. And so it's really difficult to evaluate the thickness of the necrosis when you're doing the endoscopy. And so Zarger is really kind of a good one for children. For adults, we tend to use the CT grading system, which is Sharika's CT grading system. It's fairly well established for adults, and it may potentially have benefit for children, but we just don't have good data on it. This is from his article in The Lancet. What you see here is in the grade 1 injuries, they really have minimal or somewhere. They really have fairly minimal injury to the esophageal mucosa, and this is supposed to be minimal thickening to the stomach here. Grade 2 injuries, now you've got significant thickening, but you do still see enhancement of the mucosa both in the esophagus and in the stomach. And then the grade 3 injuries, we've lost that esophageal enhancement, and so this is actually showing gastric necrosis and esophageal necrosis. What not to do. So don't induce vomiting. That basically re-exposes the esophagus to the same chemicals that cause the initial injury. Don't do gastric lavage because you risk further injury. And then don't try and neutralize the pH because that will cause an exothermic reaction, thus making it worse. What you do need to do is identify the substance and contact your poison control center. Maybe NG tube feedings are helpful. There's controversial. There's really no consensus on whether putting a feeding tube down after injury is helpful. It probably is helpful for grade 2B or higher injuries, but there have been complications reported. And then yes to oral feed. So when they're able to swallow their own saliva, it's fine to let them start drinking again. In massive ingestions, they're slightly different. So these patients need a full laboratory workup. And don't forget to get an alcohol level and a pregnancy test on females. If they have phosphoric acid or hydrofluoric acid, you're in trouble. These patients can have hypocalcemia, hyponatremia, and then both strong acids and strong alkalis can cause hypokalemia, severe acidosis, renal failure, and then thrombocytopenia. That red slide indicates that you should pay attention. Who needs surgery? Patients with transmural necrosis. So any part of the GI tract, if you've got full thickness necrosis, you need urgent surgery. Patients with perforation, so if they have peritonitis, if they go I think like on the last video, they probably have peritonitis. CT scanning is useful in identifying transmural perforation, transmural necrosis as well as perforation, and those patients need immediate surgery. And then if you get a CT scan and they have a grade 3 on the Sharika scale, those patients need urgent surgery as well. Very few children are gonna need urgent surgery, which is a great thing. But if you get in that situation, if they have necrosis of the stomach only, basically you need to do a total gastrectomy and preserve the native esophagus. Don't try and do a partial gastrectomy because generally there will be ongoing damage to the stomach. My recommendation is to avoid opening the esophageal hiatus if you can. There's a lot of negative pressure that has a tendency to pull your root limb up. So if you're doing an esophageal jejunostomy or a Hunt Lawrence pouch, it will pull that pouch and the associated root limb into the mediastinum, which causes its own set of problems. The alternative is doing damage control procedure, esophageal exclusion with or without esophageal drainage. We talked about not doing partial stomach resections. There has been direct extension into the colon reported. If you look at patients who have to have an extensive surgery, so an esophagogastrectomy, about 20% of those patients will also have extension into adjacent organs, such as the colon or potentially even the pancreas. Pancreas is rare, thank goodness. Whipple procedure or duodenal stripping has been reported in those situations, but they have a high mortality. Almost half of those patients die, and all of them have complications. If they have esophageal injuries with direct mediastinal extension, there's no great operation for that. Just do what you can. If they have extensive total bowel necrosis, their prognosis is poor, and most of those patients do not survive. On the flip side, if they just have an isolated esophageal necrosis, you can do an esophagectomy with gastric preservation. All right, questions. Steroids, yes or no? Steroids work well in animal models, but it's difficult to show a benefit in humans. There's been a randomized control trial where they randomized kids with 2B esophageal injuries, so bad but not horrible injuries, and a three-day course of high-dose methylprednisolone, 1 gram per meter square, reduced, or 1.7 meter squares, reduced the esophageal stricture rate. There were a few side effects. It was well tolerated, not a lot of bad complications. But they didn't include any patients with high-grade burns. So it's hard to know what that means in the general population. There's probably a subset that benefits. Antibiotics, yes or no? I didn't have the pleasure of that previous talk before I prepared my lecture. Now clearly the answer would be no, but it's probably indicated for grade 3 esophageal injuries because of the oral bacterial contamination. There's a risk of microabscesses. In the review by Shub in 2017, which is an excellent article, they basically said they can't really draw any conclusions about the use of antibiotics. PPIs or H2s certainly make some theoretical sense. There's a small prospective study in adults that found some benefit. In pediatric patients, we use it routinely, but again, there's no studies to show it's useful. When do you study them and how? Basically, a barium esophagogram is done in symptomatic patients a barium esophagogram is done in patients that are asymptomatic. If they have a 2B or higher injury, or if they have any symptoms, and this is generally done 2 to 3 weeks after the initial ingestion. When can you start dilating? There's no great answer on this. Some people start dilations as early as 5 days. We tend to wait at least 2 weeks before we do the initial esophageal dilations, but there's studies that show that you can dilate them early with a relatively acceptable risk of perforation. And potentially patients with early dilations may have better outcome and a lower risk for strictures, although I'm not advocating for that. We have transitioned to pneumatic balloon dilations. If they are having symptoms, we dilate them every 1 to 3 weeks until their dysphagia resolves, and then after that, we just do it based on symptoms. The patients that do poorly, those are the ones with the deeper injuries, with the 3B injuries, extensive injuries. They have long strictures or they have delayed presentations. The strictures that are hard and dense and really hard to dilate are the ones that are not going to do as well. And then patients that where every time that you go to do them, you lose the lumen, the esophageal lumen, you have to reestablish patency, those patients are not going to do well. When do you give up? Most of us try not to give up before a year. We'll try very hard to not do that at replacement. When you do get in there, it's kind of messy. That's a picture of a torn up esophagus and the associated esophagram that ultimately failed. This is an off-label use of mitomycin. Mitomycin can be used topically, so you do the endoscopy, you dilate it, and then you put mitomycin on it. The results are pretty good, so about 67% or two-thirds of patients will get complete relief, 20% have partial response, and about 13% have no improvement. It's hard to get objective data, but there are 11 publications and over 31 patients treated, and that's not counting the ones that I did that were never published. Triamcinolone has been used. I find it useless personally. Stents, this is another off-label use. I'll tell you that there are a zillion different types of stents to use. None of them are approved. When you do them, they're generally done under either esophagoscopic guidance or a fluoroscopic guidance. Complications, sometimes they're just not well tolerated. The kids will complain of chest pain and won't be able to tolerate the amount of pain they have. They can be associated with erosions, displacement, granulation tissue, and almost all of them cause reflux. If you do have to replace the esophagus, there is no perfect replacement. That's why there's so many operations described. You can use any part of the colon, the right, the transverse, the left. You can use the right with the ileum to get a better size match. Reverse gastric tubes have been used, gastric pull-ups, jejunal interpositions, and then various jejunal free flaps have also been described. There is a risk of them developing esophageal cancer, and so a patient who has had esophageal stricture from a causing congestion as a child needs to have surveillance and endoscopy beginning about 15 to 20 years after injury, and that needs to be done every 1 to 3 years. Up to 30% of these patients may actually get esophageal cancer. Thank you. I appreciate your time.
I don't know about you, I'd never heard of the drool test before. It sounds like something we should apply to our post-call faculty. Maybe. The next speaker is Sheldon Tepperman. Shel is a trauma medical director at Jacoby in the Bronx. He's going to talk to us about the trauma patient, not just on three anticoagulants, but three bad anticoagulants.
Good morning. Thanks, Dr. Maddox, Mary Ellen, for the wonderful invitation to attend this program. So I'm going to talk to you about what happens if your patient's on a whole bunch of these newfangled bad anticoagulants. And I have nothing to disclose, but we will be talking about some unlabeled use of off-label use of certain medications. And it's kind of a truism that we will see an increased number of patients on these antithrombotic medications in our trauma centers. And that has largely to do with the fact that our population is aging. So this is a study from our colleague Kim Davis from Yale and her colleagues looking at her trauma center, all admissions over the age of 50 in the years 2013 and 2014. And what first is incredible in their observations is that 77% of their trauma center admissions at Yale were simply elderly people falling down. But when they looked more specifically at the anticoagulants, they had 3,300 patients in that period of time. And almost 10% of them came in on warfarin. And a small number, but a significant number, 112, came in on the new oral anticoagulants, or the NOACs, as I like to say. So what are these things? So the first one that was out of the box was Pradaxa. So this is, by the way, all of these things affect the intrinsic clotting cascade. So Pradaxa is a fibrin inhibitor. And then there were the two newer ones that came out, rivaroxaban and apixaban, which are direct 10A inhibitors. So when the NOACs first came out at the beginning of this decade, and even from this stage, all of us predicted certain doom. But Dr. Davis and others have found that these drugs are perhaps not so scary. They're certainly less harmful than warfarin. So let's talk about warfarin for a second. Warfarin's a bad drug. It's old. It's unpredictable, requires lots of monitoring, and hopefully in the not-too-distant future, it's going to go back to its original indication, rat poisoning. So, what I'm talking to you about in the next couple of minutes is that these new oral anticoagulants are significantly less deadly when they're on board with our trauma patients. So here's what Dr. Davis found. She found in that study that patients anticoagulated on warfarin when they came in as a trauma patient had a significantly higher mortality rate, and you see it there, than the NOACs. And then Sandra Rizzoli, who's been on this stage in Toronto, also looked at this. Same thing. If the drug that you were on was a NOAC as opposed to warfarin, you had a significantly higher rate of survival if you were a trauma patient. So as I've been saying, the more we become familiar with the NOACs, the less scary they will be. So let's take a look side by side of warfarin and the NOACs. So as I said, so warfarin has a slow onset, the NOACs have a rapid one. Warfarin, Coumadin needs to be adjusted regularly, there's a fixed dose for the NOACs, and warfarin interacts with all kinds of vegetables and foods, at the very few interactions with the NOACs. And warfarin has a long half-life. You all know that when you're trying to get someone on there, it takes forever, 2 to 3 days. And the half-life of the NOAC is a half day or less. So I have this graph for you. It talks about some of the clinical indications and characteristics, including the half-life and how this stuff is metabolized, and that's in your syllabus. So let's talk about your bleeding trauma patient that now is on the NOACs. So for the most part, because of these short half-lives, you're just simply going to let the drug time out, and you're going to let it metabolize, and your intervention is just going to be waiting. Here's my general schema, my general prescription for what you're going to do with these folks. So you're going to assess the acuity of the bleeding and whether or not you need to intervene at all. And then the question is, how much of the bleeding you're experiencing with your patient is truly from the NOAC that's on board? Okay, and if you decide that you've got to do something, one thing you can do is consider preventing additional absorption of the drug with something like charcoal. And then we're going to talk about some of the more specific things you can do, which is rare, by the way. You're not going to have to do these things very often, like prothrombin complex or the specific antidotes. Okay, so what are we going to do if the patient's bleeding heavily and there's a lot of drug on board? So almost certainly, we talked about this yesterday, Dr. Joseph introduced us to this, at your trauma center, you're going to have four-factor prothrombin complex, or Kcentra. So this drug was available on the market in about 2013. It's dosed by weight, and it's almost magical for the reversal of warfarin. But it is going to be effective for the reversal of these drugs. And I would say for warfarin, it's a trauma center standard at this point in 2018. You load it up in syringe, and it's like magic. So your trauma center should have a protocol for the use of the four-component PCC. And the trauma surgeon really needs to be involved in overseeing the administration of this drug. So here you see, so this was an off-label use. We're 60 units in on a patient with a bad fall and a bad pelvic fracture, and we're going to throw everything in the kitchen sink at it. You can see that we're putting together the prothrombin complex. And there's this weird little blue doohickey that you have to know how to use. So you're going to want to have real oversight of that. And I just also pointing out, in the back there, you see this is our ICU, Jacoby, that we have a poster of our massive transfusion protocol. Any place where you're going to be doing your massive transfusion, you want to have this up on the wall so folks can refer to it. So there's been a change in the market share. You know, Pradaxa was originally the first one out. This is 2017 data. But Eliquis has taken the world by storm, and now we have rivaroxaban. And because of the legal problems that Pradaxa has been having, it's now a distant third. So this is back to Kim Davis's study at Yale. You can see that during even the course of her study, the use of these NOACs were increasing exponentially. So now we're going to talk a little bit about these very specific antidotes, which I also think you're rarely ever going to have to use. Usually you're just going to let the drug metabolize by itself. But there are specific antidotes now coming on the markets for these drugs. And the first one is for the antifibrin, for Pradaxa. And it's a monoclonal antibody, which is a complex-free drug. It has this weird name, Idarizumab, and it's kind of expensive. But for the 10As, there is a new drug coming on the market, Andexanet, and it's a fake 10A, so it complexes all of the drug. And it's just about available now, but it is crazy expensive. So I'll pause here for a second. So I've been wearing some new hats, and I see my friend George Argentonis is helping me wear these hats. He runs the trauma center at Elmhurst. So functionally, I'm functioning as the trauma medical director for the New York City Health and Hospitals trauma system. We all get together and we try to improve things, and one of our improvements is you met my wonderful OTL orthopedic trauma leader, Milan Sen, yesterday. So we're going to get together with George and my colleagues at Kings County and Elmhurst, Lincoln, Bellevue, and I don't think we're going to knock on City Hall door and say, we need this $29,000 drug that we're going to use once or nunce. So probably not going to use this drug just yet, but my thoughts may be evolving. And then there's seroprantag. So seroprantag is an inorganic molecule that is just not out yet, but it will eventually hoover up all kinds of these anticoagulants, including the heparins. And it's in phase 2 trials, and we'll look to see it probably coming out in the next decade. So, all right, we're going to put this all together, and I've been telling you that, so whether it's the Pradaxa or it's the 10A inhibitors, you're probably, at most of the time, you're just going to let the drug wear off. But let's say that you got a medium amount of bleeding. So for a medium amount of bleeding, you might try charcoal or idarumuzumab, and for rivaroxaban, probably the PCCs, either way the PCCs. But let's say you got really bad bleeding. So for really bad bleeding, you're going to throw the kitchen sink at it. And again, this is going to be rare. You have to be convinced that the drug is causing the problem. So it's going to be idarucizumab for Pradaxa, and maybe even you're going to do hemodialysis. And maybe for the 10As, you might throw andexanet if you're feeling rich on a particular day. So this is a study. It's an observational study that was done by the AAST pitting the new novel anticoagulants against everything else. So that would be antiplatelet medications and warfarin. So it was a prospective trial, and it was run by Raul Combra, who's a frequent guest of this symposium. But the first thing they tell us in the paper is that in 2016, the American College of Chest Physicians made NOACs the first line for VTE. So you know we're going to be seeing more of these drugs. But at that time, in their observation, if a trauma patient came in on anticoagulant, 50% of the time it was an antiplatelet agent, 33% of the time it was warfarin, 10% it was NOACs, and 7% of the time it was a bunch of agents. But they tell us again that we know in the future we're going to be seeing more and more and more of these NOACs, so we have to get used to them. But what they're finding specifically was that patients on NOACs had significantly lower rates of intracranial hemorrhage than the other oral anticoagulants or antiplatelet drugs. So, and when it came to aspirin, clopidogrel, and warfarin, they were associated with an increased odds ratio for death in a trauma patient, but not so much the NOACs. And surprisingly, a baby aspirin a day had the highest incidence of intracranial hemorrhage of all these agents in trauma patients. So I've been telling you all the advantages of these NOACs. So I'm thinking novel oral anticoagulants, maybe we're going to change the name. Instead of calling them novel, maybe we're going to call them the SMART. Or the SOAC, smart oral anticoagulants, because after all, they were designed in the laboratory to target one very specific part of the intrinsic clotting cascade. More of a surgical strike as compared to warfarin, which is more like a sledgehammer to the clotting cascade. Then we're going to shift gears for a moment and talk about antiplatelet therapy in the acute trauma patient. So, and Dr. Brown, who we've met earlier today, published a paper that looked at whether or not TEG can help you figure out if your patients are on these drugs premorbidly, if TEG will help you, and TEG will not help you figure out antiplatelet therapy. So the $64,000 question is, should we give a platelet transfusion to a TBI patient who is on one of these antiplatelet medications? And globally, I'm telling you the answer is not, probably not. So old friend of ours from New York, Eric Legomo, did a systematic review, and he pretty much came to the same conclusion, which is most of the time, if your patients are on antiplatelet medication, bleeding's not too severe, you're not going to use a platelet transfusion. But there's not a lot of data on this. And as of 2018, we still don't have much in the way of good prospective, randomized, carefully controlled data on this issue. There is this one trial from brain injury, which was published recently with six American trauma centers, that did come to the conclusion that platelet transfusion does not improve outcomes in patients with brain injury who are already on antiplatelet therapy. But it was a small, non-randomized controlled trial. It was very heterogeneous in terms of how severe the brain injury was. But they did come to the conclusion that platelet transfusion only minimally affects TEG, again, and it did not alter progression of CT findings if you gave a platelet transfusion. But they did have one caveat. And that is that they strongly implied that the standard of care, even though there was no data for this, is that those on antiplatelet agents and had TBI who had progression of their TBI on CT or had really bad bleeding should be transfused platelets. And I'm saying that probably myself, and we'll ask folks on the panel, but if you have a patient on these medications and if there's multiple medications on board or if they've been taking the agents recently and their TBI is severe or they've been progressing, you really should probably, in the blind, give them one round of antiapheresis platelets. No good science, but we're all probably just going to do that. So again, mild TBI on antiplatelet medications, no progression, probably not going to transfuse platelets. Severe TBI or progression, transfuse. So in conclusion, the NOACs and the antiplatelet agents are here to stay. They have a much better therapeutic to toxic profile than their older predecessors. We will see much more frequent application of these drugs in the coming years. And a deeper understanding of these class of agents will lead us to embrace them instead of running from them, as we were doing. And then finally, for TBI patients on antiplatelet medications, platelet transfusion should only be considered if there's progression of injury or if there's a severe TBI. I thank you very much.
Thank you, Sheldon, for that very slick presentation. The next speaker is Andrew Bernard, who you, I think, know. He's chief of trauma and acute care surgery at University of Kentucky at Lexington. He's going to talk to us about severe necrotizing pancreatitis.
Thank you. It's really a privilege to talk about something that I enjoy treating, as difficult a problem as it is. I don't have any conflicts to disclose. Here's what we'll talk about. I'll give you an overview of the disease and then talk about terminology. That's really the root of this talk. It's the most important thing, is this change in terminology. We'll talk about critical care, prognosis, and then intervention, what and when. About 240,000 new cases of pancreatitis each year, making it the third most common GI disease. 15 to 20% of those are going to fit into the group that we're talking about now, which is the patients with pancreatic necrosis. And the mortality in that cohort can be as high as 20%. The causes are, as you know, most commonly biliary. That's at least half of the cases. Alcohol's next, lipids, drugs. Fifth is idiopathic, although most idiopathic, we believe, are actually biliary cases where we just can't see the debris in the gallbladder that would be causing the biliary pancreatitis. The crux of this is this new Atlanta classification, which divides the terminology in pancreatitis into four different categories, and that those four categories are two and two, separated by a four-week timeline. So let me walk you through these. So these are the four types of pancreatitis now by the Atlanta classification. Let me just first say, this is a classification system that is not necessarily perfect, but this is how it's set up. There's before 4 weeks and after 4 weeks. And in each of those categories, one of these is with necrosis and the other is without necrosis. And then in each of these four, it can be infected and non-infected. So before 4 weeks, there's acute peripancreatic fluid collection. This is standard pancreatitis with a big swollen edematous pancreas. And then the necrotic version would be that with some dead pancreas. After 4 weeks, it's pancreatic pseudocyst, which is this nice, very well-defined, purely fluid collection with no solid debris in it, no necrosis. And then the necrotic version of that, and the necrotic sibling would be walled-off pancreatic necrosis, which is that with some debris or some necrosis in it. So let me show you some pictures to illustrate this. For each of these slides, on the left, you'll see the four different types, the four different presentations of pancreatitis. The yellow highlighted one is the one shown in the picture. So first off, in the early group, without necrosis, acute peripancreatic fluid collection, you see a big, swollen, kind of fuzzy-looking pancreas with stranding around it. The pancreas is alive. Standard pancreatitis, which is swollen. Here's that version with some necrosis. So it's a peripancreatic fluid collection, and part of the pancreas doesn't enhance. So post-necrotic pancreatic or peripancreatic fluid collection. So that's before 4 weeks. Now, after 4 weeks, you have these two. There is this standard thing that we've always known as the pancreatic pseudocyst, although we don't operate it on it as much as we used to, unfortunately, because it's a great operation. Nice, well-defined, and purely liquid with no necrosis in the pancreas and really not any solid debris in there. And then the necrotic sister or sibling of that, walled-off pancreatic necrosis. Again, fairly well-defined. This thing has solid debris in it, and there's a necrotic pancreatic tissue there. Again, not everything fits in there. So phlegmon, that's a term I've always used for pancreatitis that's big and swollen, maybe necrosis, maybe not. It doesn't fit in this classification, but we might use that term when we talk to each other. Infected pseudocyst does exist. That would be the after 4 weeks without a lot of necrosis, but infected. You just can't use that term for everything. Not everything falls into that category now. That's only one of the four types. Hemorrhagic pancreatitis doesn't really fit well in the classification. And some people talk about ongoing or persistent acute pancreatitis. That doesn't really fit in the Atlanta classification either. So critical care. Resuscitation ought to be good, basic critical care. Crystalloid resuscitation, the right amount. Not too much, not too little. So use some kind of resuscitation guide. If you like bicarb, great. Lactate, great. Pulse pressure variation, SCVO2, whatever it is you like to determine whether somebody's resuscitated, be mindful about it. If you get them too swollen, you're going to have problems with abdominal compartment syndrome and oxygenation and everything else, right? So use some resuscitation guides. Beware of abdominal compartment syndrome. Enteral nutrition reduces death, multiple organ failure, intervention, sepsis, length of stay. Feed them in their gut if you can. And it's okay to feed them in their stomach. If they don't tolerate gastric feeding, then feed them in their small bowel with a long tube, and TPN would be your last choice. Antibiotics empirically should be avoided, so no prophylactic antibiotics. No role for routine ERCP, no role for probiotics. I'm talking about severe pancreatitis cases. No role for probiotics, no role for octreotide, no role for routine abdominal reimaging. You can reimage based upon symptoms. The prognosis is about 15% mortality overall in patients with pancreatic necrosis. You can predict these objectively. Apache, Baltazar, Ransom, all these are fine ways to predict outcome. Your clinical sense is probably just as good as those. You know what somebody sick in the ICU looks like. They're tachycardic. They may be hypotensive. They require a lot of fluid. They breathe fast. They just look and burn hot. They're hypoxic, they're oliguric, they don't wake up right, they're sick. You can look at those patients and pretty much eyeball them and know that you're in for a long run. So how about timing? What intervention and when do you do it? Early resection and debridement doesn't have a role specifically with regards to the pancreas. It doubles the mortality. So if you dive into the pancreas early, your mortality may be more like 50% and less like 25%. You can lose liters of blood in one of these really inflamed pancreatitis cases, and there's just no mortality benefit. So patients, you have to just not bite too early. The mortality can be as low as 4% if you time it right. Now, that's specifically for the pancreas. If one of your bad pancreatitis cases suddenly declines, then you have to wonder about whether something else in there is dead, the gallbladder, the colon. I did one of these last week, a dead left colon in a patient with pancreatitis, or abdominal compartment syndrome. So you might need to intervene early for those, but you're rarely going to intervene early for the pancreas. Should rarely occur before day 28. This pancreas has to get good and liquid in order for it to come out well. So early multiple organ failure shouldn't prompt you to dive in early. You just need to relax and watch and give them good critical care. Don't let this compel you to give them antibiotics, because they're probably going to get antibiotics somewhere along the way for something, so save that. Put that in your back pocket. Don't let it force your hand to dive in. Indications for intervention at some point are going to be gastric outlet obstruction, biliary obstruction, infection, persistent SIRS. Now, they just won't cool off several weeks in. It's time to think about when you're going to drain them, or a rapid increase in size. Those are all would be indications. So let me walk you through these four approaches. Endoscopic, this is probably the optimal approach simply because it's the least invasive approach. That can be a single procedure. It's usually multiple procedures. Requires you to have a good interventional endoscopist. Percutaneous is an option, can be very effective. It's just laborious. You start with a small drain, you go to a bigger drain, and it requires a lot of in and out, and it requires a really engaged interventional radiologist. The lap videoscopic approach is very gratifying surgically and I think very effective. We just often don't get to that point anymore because we have so many good interventional gastroenterologists out there. Principles are the same. Just get the dead, liquefied pancreas out of the patient. It's a really easy approach via the left gutter. I'll show you a video of that. And the last approach would be open. We hardly ever do these anymore. So this is endoscopic intervention. This is using a lumen-opposing stent that's through the stomach into the necrotic fluid collection, and you see the interventional gastroenterologist just doing the debridement that we all used to do through a big midline or a chevron with a ring forceps or a sponge or whatever. They're doing it through the mouth now. This is the percutaneous approach. Starts with a small drain to access it, and then you might do this over, with your finger and upsize the drain in the operating room, or you might have your radiologist do this. This is external drainage percutaneously. This is the videoscopic approach, so this is VARD, resection and debridement of the pancreas. I'm standing on the patient's right, reaching over. You see the Deaver in the top of the field here, and the resident's holding a laparoscope with one hand and the sucker tip with the other. When it starts to bleed, you're done for the day. Leave a drain there and then come back the next day, and you can do this serially just like the interventional radiologist would. So that, you know, you have to wait until this is nice and ready, though. This phlegmon matures and it starts to necessitate toward the side, and you dive in usually right over here. The right gutter would be another approach. It just depends upon where the anatomy is. And this is classic open debridement of pancreatic necrosis, which we don't do so much anymore. So the principles of intervention are just to get that necrotic pancreas out. If you can do that relatively minimally invasively, that's great for the patient. Complications can be disastrous, obviously. If you get bleeding and you think it could be arterial, angioembolization would be the way to go. Thankfully, if it's venous bleeding, it's relatively low pressure. You may be compelled to operate one of these cases that gets significant venous bleeding, and in those cases, you might find something to clip, or you might just have to pack and hope that it stops. Pancreatic fistulae, if it's a patient who's been drained out the flank by you or by the radiologist, can end up being a problem. They almost always close. You'll wait and wait and wait a number of months before you would dive back into those cases. So the key points here are good early resuscitation, good critical care, enteral nutrition, keep the faith. They're going to look terrible. They're going to have multiple organ failure. They're going to be on renal replacement therapy, and they're hypoxic, and they just, every day they look hot. Just keep the faith. They're going to get better. Their pancreas is eventually going to burn out, and they'll cool off, or it'll liquefy to the point that you can go after it, either with your GI doctor or radiologist or you, and then they'll really cool off after that, and then their organ failure will get better. Intervene late. It needs to be ready before you go in there. Your options for intervening will depend upon what you have at your place and where in the abdomen that fluid collection is sitting. So this is our algorithm at the University of Kentucky. I put it in your syllabus, and I could just walk you through this a little bit. Note that it starts with case reviewed by the endoscopist, the surgeon, and the interventional radiologist. This is multidisciplinary here. Look at the scan with the people who will help you do this, either a radiologist or an endoscopist. Now, is intervention indicated? Well, who would that be? Like I said, those are people with active infection, persistent organ failure now, several weeks in, with a pancreas that's ready to be drained, gastric or biliary obstruction. Those would be the reasons to go for it. Or persistent intractable pain. So now this would sort of fall into the category of the classic patient who's got a persistent pseudocyst, who we used to drain. If it's mature and encapsulated over on the far left of the screen, nice walled off pancreatic necrosis that's adjacent to the foregut, they're gonna get it through the mouth. It's gonna be the easiest approach. Over on the far right, the immature, non-encapsulated acute necrotic collection, that's gonna be tougher for the endoscopist to get, certainly without risking opening the GI tract into a non-contained space. They're gonna be less comfortable with that. That's going to be one that's better drained externally or by you surgically, hopefully through one of the flanks, maybe through the midline at your last resort. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Andrew. Great talk. Next speaker is going to be my own good friend and partner, Dr. Andre Campbell, who's going to talk to us about trauma in the pregnant patient. Andre.
Thank you. I just want to start off by thanking Dr. Maddox for having me back this year. Also to thank Mary Allen and the program committee for the invitation to speak today. Today I'm going to talk about a topic that will give most of you a little bit dyspepsia, a little bit uncomfortableness. It's not something that we want to see, but it's just a fact of life. So I'll start off by saying I have no disclosures this morning for this, other than I'm a trauma surgeon and I've taken care of a number of pregnant women over these many years that I've been doing it at San Francisco General Hospital. So we'll talk a little bit about the anatomy, the overall approach There's a number of physiological changes that were associated with pregnancy you need to know about. Talk about resuscitative strategies and how to approach it and operative considerations, and then we'll get into some of the nitty-gritty of things as we sort of move through this discussion over the next 15 minutes or so. So it is a major problem. It's about 5 to 7 percent of women who are pregnant will sustain some sort of trauma. It is a leading cause of non-obstetrical maternal death. Motor vehicle accidents are greater than abuse, greater than falls. Remember that pregnant patients are somewhere in the order of 8 or 9 times more commonly assaulted in terms of interpersonal violence. So this is a problem that if you recognize that you need to screen for this when they come in to the emergency room. If something seems a little strange when they come in and you're trying to sort things out, please be aware of that. Also falls. And then in terms of fetal death, the estimated 4 to 61% maternal death equals fetal death. And again, motor vehicle accidents greater than gunshot wounds or stab wounds greater than falls. And there are complications even with minor trauma. I'll show you that. So, but only less than 1% or 0.4% require hospitalization. So it's a small group of patients. And this is just an example of a case of a woman who has been shot. And this is kind of what it looks like when the fetus has been injured and has been delivered in terms of dealing with injuries. But you can see that even though it looks fairly innocuous and that obviously there's a lot of space there, that the fetus can easily be injured from a penetrating injury there. So remember, there are two patients. This is just a diagram that really shows you the development of the fetus over time. We're going to talk about some of these anatomical and physiological things that happen. But remember, you want to focus on the mother, right? So what are the things that are going to kill the mother when they're in your trauma room, when you're doing your initial assessment on the patient? So there's anatomical change, physiological change. You can kind of see from this that the fetus, as this is a more full-term pregnancy, you can see that the fetus is quite large. The placenta and the uterus takes up a lot of space, and I'll kind of show you other projections just to kind of give you an idea if you haven't operated or haven't seen, have done surgery in this kind of situation. It is quite amazing sight to see a fully gravid fetus inside of a uterus. So you can see how high it goes. It's almost up to the diaphragm. And you can see that if the abdominal contents are pushed up, there's going to be a lot of anatomical changes. If you think about rough landmarks at the level of the umbilicus, is about 20 weeks. So that's kind of where you're at in terms of doing the assessment, we're doing stuff. So this is just a CT scan just to kind of show you the amount of space that the uterus takes up when you have a gravid uterus and how everything is really sort of pushed up and really pushed apart. So, and I'll go through some of what that means in terms of your resuscitation a little bit. And you can see how small that area is that the viscera intestinal contents are really occupy now. And you can see this is kind of some of the changes. So the diaphragms come up, and of course the respiratory changes that happen. The pelvis will relax and open up to accommodate the fetus, and so that's a normal part of anatomy. So with the anatomical changes, when you're doing procedures, whether that's chest tubes or doing other sort of interventions, you need to make sure you're aware of the anatomy as you go through this, because otherwise you're going to be doing fetoscopy or you're going to be injuring the fetus, which you don't want to do, right? So the other thing to remember is that the fetus takes a lot of space, as I said. And what happens is if you put the trauma patient in the normal position, which is supine, this is going to cause a problem because there is actually a supine hypotension syndrome, which many of you may be familiar with, because what happens is the fetus will sit on the cava and the aorta. And if that's the case, then you could really decrease the cardiac output by 30%, which is really quite a lot. And so if there's a problem, you put them in lateral decubitus position, you do that. So there's hematological changes, cardiovascular changes, respiratory changes, endocrine and gastroenterology changes, and I'll go through some of that now. There's changes in maternal blood volume. As you probably know already, there's increased RBC volume by 20 or 30%. There's increased plasma volume, which also goes up too. And there's an anemia that's associated with pregnancy, which is also a normal part of pregnancy. There's an increased heart rate that goes on, and there's a decrease in blood pressure, and that is exacerbated or increased a bit during the second trimester of pregnancy. There's increased cardiac output, because obviously there's more increased demands because of the demands from the fetus and the uterus, because the uterus is getting larger. There's increased oxygen demands, there's increased uterine blood flow, and that could take up to 1/5 of the cardiac output. So that's really quite a bit. And it's shunted away when hemorrhage happens, the blood flow is shunted away from the uterus during hemorrhage. So as you would think that because the uterus goes up and the amount of space that the lung occupies goes down, what's going to happen is you're going to have a bit of increase in some minute ventilation, you're going to have increased tidal volume and some changes, but you'll have decreased FRC and residual volume, and the patients are hypercapnic, so their PCO2 will be lower than what it is in a normal patient. Right, the white count can actually go up fairly significantly as sort of other changes that will happen during pregnancy. These patients can be hypercoagulable because of the risk of DVT. And the gastrointestinal changes that happen. As you can see, if the uterus is going up and pushing against the lower esophageal sphincter, there's going to be changes. So the patients will be experiencing things related to reflux and those kind of things. And there's going to be a gastric compression because there's just less space for things to occupy. Now remember, as we go through the basic things, these are all part of basic ATOS. And when the patients come in, go through all those, make sure you do it religiously. They focus on the big stuff because that'll be what's going on. What you do for the trial patients who are pregnant, what you'll do is you'll get early obstetric consultation. They'll come in, and actually they're part of the activation, depending on the level of pregnant, how long the woman is far along. You may even have pediatrics there if there's an issue related to a possible delivery. You'll do a vaginal exam looking for blood, amniotic fluid, lacerations. There'll be a uterine exam also as part of the physical exam, and that there could be fetal monitoring and radiology as we go along, especially if it's over 20 weeks. And this is kind of just a picture of some of what it would look like getting a radiology scan. So remember, there are two patients. The pregnant patient should not be penalized for being pregnant. So you may want to make sure that you do what has to be done, right, to make sure you're doing the right thing. Again, focusing on the mother is something that is really key when you're taking care of a pregnant woman. Now, I'm going to get into the hard part here, and this is the part that I always, you know, think about, and I always think about this as kind of a Hiroshima Nagasaki situation where we start talking about radiation, everybody gets upset, you know, everybody gets all bent out of shape, but the reality is you got to do what is the right thing for the patient. So you want to avoid unnecessary imaging, but you have to get in imaging if the patient is seriously injured, so you use shielding. So this is just a projection of the amount of fetal dosing related to that, so very low for things like x-rays, and if you shield them, it's less. If you take bigger slices, it's even less too, but a pan scan is less than 5 rads. So that's just to kind of give you an idea of what it is and what it is, depending on what the density of the slices is when you're doing a CT scan. So in terms of summary radiation, this is what it is. If it's less than, this is just the number of weeks in the pregnancy, and what the effect is. If it's less than 5 rads, if it's greater than 5 to 50 rads, that's when you can have issues, because these are critical periods where you can have problems related to that. So you can have some incidence of over when very, very early fetus within the first 2 weeks, there can be major problems, including death and demise, and there's somatic defects and issues related to mental status as you move along. But over 16 weeks, there's not much effect. So this is the thing that is the big thing. It's actually, there's minimal data on it, but you hear it every time a pregnant patient comes in, like what is the risk here? And this is what the CDC has estimated what the risk of lifetime childhood cancer is. Just from background radiation, it's 0.3%. 0 to 5 rads is 0.3 to 1%, and 5 to 50 rads is 1 to 6%. It's still fairly low, but if the patient is dying or the mother's dying, you need to get the studies you need to get. So the consensus opinion or consensus statement from the OBGYN Society or ACOG is that most diagnostic radiological procedures are associated with little, if any, known significant fetal risk. So this is sort of something that you want to take, the messages I want you to take home, that there's fairly low risk, but you need to be aware of them when you do that. The things that are non-invasive, that's easy, that you could do, is like getting a FAST, as you're all aware of. It's actually pretty good. It's reproducible, obviously, for blunt trauma more than penetrating trauma. This is generally what the sensitivity and specificity is. It's usually pretty good if you can get a good study. You can also check on the fetal heart tones when you're doing that, too. This is what it looks like, fetal monitoring. I think many of you are aware of that and kind of what that looks like, making sure you get those OBGYN nurses who from maternity were to come and help you to sort of set this up, to kind of take a look if the patient is over 23 or 24 weeks. But even you'll do it even if they're early, just to make sure everything's okay. So maternal indications of surgery, these are the kind of the things that really get your attention. Things like peritonitis, hemodynamic instability. You can see the blood there outside of where the fetus is located. Abruptio placenta, this is something that can be very lethal, where you basically have abruption of the placenta. And then uterine rupture was obviously the worst nightmare, where the fetus is free-floating in the intraperineal cavity. And this is kind of the types of placenta abruption. There's external abruption, relatively concealed abruption, and then concealed abruption there too. So these are the classifications of abruptio placenta. So this is sort of something that you need to have in your back of your mind when you do that. And this is what it looks like on CT scan. You can see the blood that's inside the uterus there, that's pointing at the arrow there. So if an operation is required, a cesarean section, it is done. It is done emergently. But most patients are not injured, as I said, low. Penetrating trauma, it's a priority, it's the same as a non-pregnant patient. So think about fetal injury, maternal injury, and C-section as with blunt. And is there injury to the uterus? And I'm going to show you some pictures of that. This is a penetrating injury of a woman who is pregnant and what has happened to her. And this is kind of, I showed you some of these slides, which are obviously difficult to look at, but these are the things that can happen with the patient there. So this is kind of, you can see that there's a bullet that's intra-abdominal, and you can see that the fetus has been injured there with an injury to the left part of the side of the chest. This is what it looks like when the uterus has been injured from a gunshot wound. This is a hole in the uterus, and that is, there's been delivery of the fetus, and it's being repaired. You can see the midline incision that was made in the uterus there, and then the hole that's in the uterus that has been fixed after delivery of the fetus. So, and this is what has happened from the injury from that fetus there, just to sort of give you an idea what that looks like. But obviously, it can be quite lethal, and you need to be aware of that and mindful of that when the patient comes in to be seen. So injuries to the uterus is less than 23 weeks. You want to repair the uterus and observe. Greater than 23 weeks, depending on if there's distress or not in the fetus, you're going to do a C-section. If it's less than 23 weeks, no distress, you know, what do you do? So 23 is the point of viability to do that. And I'll kind of go through an algorithm here in a little bit just to kind of give you an idea to do that. So early on, you try to repair and observe. Later on, then you may have to deliver and do a C-section. But the most important thing is the point of viability, understanding where you're at with doing things. So sometimes I have to actually coax the OB-GYNs to come down if somebody's very early in the pregnancy. But I think that I want to make sure that I know that they are assessing the fetus as we go along. In terms of perimortem sections, or if there's a maternal cardiac arrest that happens, it's important for you to move very quickly, so that's why you need to have the backup team there. Whether that it should usually happen down in the ED. If there's a cardiac arrest, you have to move fairly fast. You want to make sure you have a viable fetal age when it happens. But the intervention has to be really quite quick, so you have to have the whole setup and ready to go. And the survival is rated to gestational age. Obviously, if the fetus is more mature, there's a greater chance that it could survive, but it really depends on what the degree of injury is that the fetus has. So this is a little bit of an algorithm as I begin to kind of wrap up things in the last minute or so of the talk. And the main thing is you get the pre-hospital report, you stabilize the patient, and it's always the same as we do with ATLS every day as we sort of go through the trauma assessment. You do a complete exam. You're looking for external hemorrhage. You want to really focus on what has happened. You want to think about the things I've talked about. Does the woman have shock? Does she have peritonitis? Is she in distress? What is going on with her? Just so you can clarify what the problems are. You do a pelvic exam to see if there's abruptio placenta or blood. You want to document what the fetal heart rate is. You know, is the fetus greater than or less than 23 weeks? This is the algorithm from the University of Michigan, which they put out a number of years ago. So that's what I'm sharing with you here, and it's inside the syllabus also. You know, so what you're going to do then is initiate fetal monitoring. So you bring down the OBGYN nurses to kind of help you once you've gone through the primary and secondary survey if the patient is stable. If not, then you have to move faster. And you're going to evaluate the patient for significant vaginal bleeding, rupture of amniotic fluid membranes, whether or not they're in labor or not. So what you'll do is if you think they're in labor, they've been injured, you're going to bring them in, hospitalize them, observe them for 24 hours if they've not been injured. So remember, the majority of these patients are not significantly injured because, remember, the fetus is actually fairly protected. But there are cases where the fetus has been injured, and I showed you some of those. So after a monitoring period, you'll discontinue monitoring, the patient can be safely discharged. little bit about autoimmunization here. When the woman is negative and there's trauma, there's an exposure and there's an immune response that happens, and the Klein-Howard-Betke test is done. You guys should give the woman Rogam to make sure that she doesn't have an immune response. Depending on the level of the pregnancy, you give either 150 or 350 micrograms of the drug. And this is what just a picture of what it is. So in conclusion here, as I begin to wrap up, it is a common problem in pregnant patients, but most are not significantly injured. You have to understand the anatomical and physiological changes that happen in women, and it's just quite different, and you need to understand that. You want to focus on the mother and what her injuries are when you do that. The basics of ATLS are always the same as you do that. Judicious use of radiological evaluations with ED, OB, trauma involvement. You need to have all the parties there to do that. The fetal evaluations depend on the stage of pregnancy and pregnancy-specific issues I talked about. An emergency C-section may be required. So with that, I want to thank you for your attention this morning, and I'm happy to entertain any questions and discussion.
Thanks, Andre. Final speaker of the session. Oh, there she is. Dr. Jennifer Gurney, the trauma surgeon, acute care surgeon extraordinaire, is chief of trauma systems development at USIS down in San Antonio. She's going to talk to us about common bile duct injury, not from trauma, I think, but from lap colis. Jennifer.
Thanks, Dr. McCursey. Thank you, Dr. McCursey. It really is a privilege to be speaking at this meeting. Thanks, Dr. Maddox, Mary Allen, and the program committee. So my disclosures, I am in the military, and I am not an expert on bile duct injuries. I guess that's probably not necessarily a bad thing. So since most of us are not going to be actually doing these repairs, we're going to talk initially about how this iatrogenic catastrophe of a bile duct injury is really associated with significant morbidity. You know, we want our post-op gallbladder patients to look like this a few days post-op and not be in the hospital with multiple drains draining bile. Now, you know, when we have a gallbladder case and we do a good gallbladder, we don't walk out and high-five like a mediastinal traverse injury or a clamshell. But I'll tell you, if somebody has a gallbladder complication, there's certainly plenty of critics that emerge. So the overview of this talk, we're going to talk about patient factors that predispose to bile duct injury, surgeon factors, strategies to avoid injury, the types of injury, and different management strategies once bile duct injuries are recognized. So we've all had these patients Friday night on call, 70-year-old, morbidly obese, diabetic, comes in with right upper quadrant pain, has had multiple episodes of cholecystitis. He gets an ultrasound, and if you can even see the gallbladder, there's a thickened gallbladder wall, maybe with gallbladder emphysema like you can see. Now, if you take this patient to the operating room in the middle of the night by yourself with the OR nurse who normally works in the ophthalmology room during the day who's just covering, you have to be prepared for a plan. You have to have an open cholecystectomy potentially as a plan. It certainly is not a failure. So you have to be prepared for that and for other different types of bailout procedures. And we're going to talk a little bit about those. If you do have to convert to an open cholecystectomy, there is a higher likelihood of having a duct injury or even a vascular injury. Dr. Inaba, who we've heard about or heard from a couple times during this meeting, looked at 214 patients with complicated cholecystitis. And looking at open cholecystectomy, there's actually a 3.3% incidence of common bile duct injury, which is pretty high, but these are complex patients. You wouldn't have opened them if it wasn't going to be a difficult case. And also, our open experience is decreasing exponentially. If you do have to open, you have to keep the bailout procedures, such as subtotal cholecystectomy, which we'll talk about in mind. So now we're going to talk about aberrant anatomy. There's a few variants in anatomy that you have to be familiar with. Variable anatomy with the biliary tree is common. And you should expect that. You know, you shouldn't expect everybody to look normal. All the pictures that we see in the textbooks, those are quite rare. One of the aberrant anatomies is having kind of a hidden cystic duct, and this can be because of inflammation or because that there's a common sheath that's fusing the cystic duct with a common bile duct or common hepatic duct. And you can see how that would really put the duct at injury if you don't really open the triangle of Collot. I think we've probably all seen the short cystic duct, especially in chronic cholecystitis, where you can have multiple impacted stones. These stones can actually form fistulas to the common hepatic or to the common bile duct. And knowing this preoperatively and having a bailout plan, such as a subtotal cholecystectomy, will help decrease injury with that. Now, if you're going to learn one thing this talk, this is a slide you should learn. In 1 out of 50, or 2% of patients, there is a very low takeoff of the right posterior sectoral duct. Now, this duct can even come right off the cystic duct. So 1 out of 50 patients have this, and it's really hard to recognize. And you can see that even if you open the triangle of Collot, this duct is still at risk of injury. And this is a common reason in the classifications that we'll talk about shortly for ductal injury. And then we're all familiar with the ducts of Luschka, or the subvesical bile ducts. Really, the way to avoid bile leaks from these is when you're taking the gallbladder off the liver bed, stay out of the liver. Do your very best to stay out of the liver. There can be danger there as well. So aberrant anatomy is just the anatomy. Sometimes it's surgeon disorientation, but it's usually just the anatomy. So we're going to talk now about surgeon factors, because certainly things that we do will affect whether or not a patient has a duct injury. In a survey that was done by SAGES, about 70% of surgeons said that common bile ducts were unavoidable. Approximately 40 to 50% of surgeons have had a major bile duct injury, and most of these occur within the surgeon's first 100 laparoscopic cholecystectomies, but a third of these do occur after 200. We know that experience and training cannot be overstated. The incidence of bile duct injury is about 3 in 1,000. It might be going down. And now, one of the things to decrease the risk of incidence is to obtain the critical view of safety, and I'll show you pictures of this shortly. But when, in a survey, only one-third of surgeons report obtaining the critical view of safety every gallbladder, which means 70% don't. And in the same survey, 20% of surgeons were unable to identify the critical view of safety, so that's really concerning. And then we're all subject to visual heuristics, and this is our mind playing tricks on us, our brain seeing what it thinks it's going to see. So when you look at this picture, do you see a Dalmatian? Anybody see a dog with spots? If you don't, that's good, actually. If you do, you're subject to visual heuristics. Okay, so your mind is playing tricks on you. What about this one? Does anybody see a white triangle here? Who doesn't see a white triangle? Okay, so everybody here is subject to visual heuristics, or their mind playing tricks on them, because there's no white triangle here. This is just different sections of circles. Now, watch this. This is my favorite. This square doesn't change colors, but your mind is filling in the gaps, and it does. And it does this during laparoscopic cholecystectomies. You see the anatomy that you want to see. So should you have another surgeon in the operating room with you? If you have that luxury, that's awesome. But you should have a skilled first assistant. That's good for you, that's good for the patient. And studies that have looked at that have shown a decreased incidence. Now, we all know a lot of us are doing these by ourselves with inexperienced techs, but when it gets hard, that's when you call for help. Now, people say this they talk about the difficult gallbladder and misidentifying the duct. Well, let's look at a difficult gallbladder. Or maybe this gallbladder isn't so difficult. Actually, 60% of duct injuries occur in the not-so-difficult gallbladder. So you can see there's a duct coming into view, and they're seeing the white triangle. And they're putting clips on something without obtaining the critical view of safety. And cutting something, angering the dragon in the corner of every room. And now they're starting to obtain the critical view of safety. So you already see the clip on the duct. And something else is coming into play. As they're lateralizing the gallbladder, which you should do from the very beginning to open the Collot, there's another duct. Now, that makes, this is like watching a horror movie. I've seen this a few times now, and it's every time it's like watching a horror movie. But this surgeon was subject to visual heuristics, perceiving what they wanted, what they thought they were seeing. So let's talk about strategies to avoid bile duct injuries. SAGES has done a fantastic job of creating this culture of safety in cholecystectomy, and we're going to talk about that. There's strategies that are described, and if you go to the SAGES website, there's tons of teaching material, and it's all really, really excellent. So the first thing is to confirm the critical view of safety, so that's completely opening closed triangle with this doublet view. Okay, now if all gallbladders look like this, I don't think there'd be any common duct injuries. They rarely do. So after you obtain the critical view of safety from the anterior side, you switch it to the posterior side, so move the infundibulum medially so you can get a look at the critical view of safety on the other side and be sure that there's no other ducts that you're seeing. Looking for aberrant anatomy, we already talked about that. You have to know it in order to look for it. And liberal use of cholangiography. So what does the data say about cholangiography?
60% of the time, it works every time. That doesn't make sense.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense. So there hasn't been any prospective randomized study looking at IOCs with duct injury. And, you know, it's getting harder to get fluoroscopy licensed. Some states, it's quite restrictive. But liberal use of cholangiography is probably worthwhile, and routine use might is likely to be cost-effective. So anybody use ICG in here, Indocyanine Green? So a few people. You know, it's pretty amazing. So ICG is a water-soluble, non-toxic substance that's been used for a long time to look at liver as excretory function. And when and it's mostly used in robotic surgery. And if you watch this video, it's really pretty awesome. So you can see everything with bile in it lights up. So you can really see the common duct and the common hepatic duct. And you can see they just pointed the cystic duct right there. When they lateralize the infundibulum, you can get a good idea of the anatomy. And I think this, to me, this is much superior to intraoperative cholangiography using ICG. The fourth strategy is an intraoperative timeout. And this is just a 20-second pause to confirm that you've seen the critical view of safety from both the anterior and posterior side. And then recognizing danger. Sometimes it's easy to recognize danger, and sometimes it's not so easy. So if you're dissecting by Ruvier's sulcus, which is where the right portal pedicle enters into the liver, you want to be above that. If you see this fissure and you're working below it, you are in a danger zone. So you want to be working above this fissure. The second thing is, even if the duct looks small, if you can see the duodenum, which you can see at the bottom of this picture, the duct is going behind the duodenum, that is not the cystic duct. So if you're looking at the duodenum, you're also too low. And then these other things, such as this thick gallbladder wall or not being able to find the gallbladder, the omentum being scarred up to the gallbladder, at this point you know you're in trouble. This is going to be a challenging cholecystectomy, and you need to be starting to think about your bailout plans. And then get help. I had a video for this, but I was going to be over time. But you know, if you're having a hard time in the operating room, do yourself a favor and do your patient a favor and get help. So what are the different bailout plans? Okay, knowing when to stop. So how do you do the impossible cholecystectomy? How do you do the impossible? You don't. You don't do the impossible cholecystectomy. You stop, and you either place a cholecystostomy tube or do a subtotal cholecystectomy. So if you can only visualize the dome of the gallbladder, then place a cholecystostomy tube. If the interventional radiologist can do it, we can certainly do it. It certainly isn't very hard. You purse string the tube in. You don't have to get the gallbladder up to the abdominal wall, and then you drain it. And if you cannot safely dissect out the hepatocystic triangle, then you do a subtotal cholecystectomy. So different types of subtotal cholecystectomy are either fenestrated, where you leave the gallbladder open. You can purse string the duct from the inside or not, because it's usually already obliterated. Or you can reconstitute it. So once you've, if you've done it laparoscopically and it looks something like this, you have two choices. You can reconstitute it. And one out of five of these patients will have recurrent cholecystitis. Or you can just leave it open. If you do that, you just have to drain. Actually, with both of these, you should drain. And if there's a bile leak post-op, or if you're concerned about the anatomy, early diagnosis of an injury is super important. So you want to get an early post-op ERCP. So we're going to briefly talk about classifications, the Bismuth classification, the Strasburg. Dr. Maddox has a classification for bile duct injuries. Dr. Maddox's classification considers the injury factors such as laceration, transection, perforation. It's more for trauma. And then the Stewart Way classification. So Strasburg's classification, type A is a bile leak from the cystic duct or bed without any injury. So this is your cystic duct stump or duct of Luschka. It's usually just treated with ERCP. Type B and type C are with that right posterior duct that we talked about. And then type D is lateral injuries to the major bile ducts without any loss of continuity. And then type E are the old Bismuth classification, and these are the major bile duct injuries. The Stewart-Wade classification depends on the how the injury was made. So class one is when the common bile duct is mistaken for the cystic duct. Frequently, this can be recognized in the operating room. This is kind of the classic, all the ducts get cut. And then class two is lateral damage to the common hepatic duct. This is usually associated with bleeding and injury to one of the major vascular structures as well. Class three is when the common bile duct is mistaken for the cystic duct or the common hepatic duct. And then class four is the right hepatic duct is mistaken for the cystic duct. All of this is really detailed in the syllabus. So if you look in the syllabus, you can go through it. So now, if you recognize a bile leak postoperatively, if your patient has a drain and a lot of bile is coming out, or they come in and they have a bioloma, then you want to get further investigation. It needs to be drained. Now, if it's a high output drainage, either early or late, they need to get an ERCP to define the anatomy. If it's low output drainage, you can watch and manage this expectantly. It'll usually resolve in about 5 to 7 days. If it doesn't resolve, or if the output increases, or if the patient's not doing right, I mean, that's the thing with these post-op patients. If they're not doing well, if they're not getting better every day, just assume something's wrong and do the, you know, the appropriate evaluation. Get an ERCP and further imaging. If you diagnose the bile leak intraoperatively, then you have a couple choices. Well, if it's a major injury, so if the patient has a major injury or minor injury, so minor injury, so all the books say repair over a T-tube. Some of the articles say get help, and I agree with that. I would get help because I would also want all the other anatomy to be confirmed. Do an IOC, and if you're going to repair this over a T-tube, have one of your trusted partners come in with you. If it's a major duct injury and there's no experienced HPB in your hospital, then clip the duct, drain, IV antibiotics, and refer them to a tertiary center. Most tertiary centers and everything that's written about duct injuries say that these patients should go to tertiary centers. This is, of course, biased because patients get their ducts fixed over T-tubes and they don't make it into these studies. But in general, if you get sued for something like this, they should be at a tertiary center. And then if it's a major injury and there's an experienced HPB surgeon in your hospital, then get help. And the most likely thing that they'll do is a Roux-en-Y hepaticojejunostomy. Now, intraoperative diagnosis. If you start seeing bile leaking in the field and you suspect an intraoperative bile duct injury, it really depends on the type of injury, if it's a sharp injury or if it's a thermal injury. If it's a sharp injury, first, get help. Don't do this. But even if you're an experienced hepatobiliary surgeon, you have to get help. Because you don't want to be the person doing the repair after you've made the injury. So if it's a total transection or partial transection with a sharp injury, repair it over a T-tube. But if the duct has been resected, then again, it depends on surgeon experience. Inexperienced surgeon, drain and refer. An experienced surgeon with help, then they go ahead and get a Roux-en-Y hepaticojejunostomy. Thermal injuries, again, always depends on experience. Inexperienced surgeon, drain and refer. An experienced surgeon, resection and reconstruction. So in summary, know the anatomy and be prepared. There is a dragon in the corner of every room. If it doesn't seem right with these patients, like Dr. Wall said earlier, hope is not a plan, hope is not a strategy. If it doesn't seem right, it's probably not right. Intraoperative imaging is likely helpful. Always have a bailout plan for these patients. Get help early, get help often. Early recognition of injury, because early repair is better for patients if it's recognized early, and do no further harm. Thanks so much for your attention. I appreciate it.
Panelists to the front. We've only got 15 minutes to do this. I want to thank the audience for their questions. I keep my own little list, and I'm not going to need to use them at all. There were some really good questions. Unfortunately, as you might imagine, they're way more than we can cover in the next 15 minutes or so. But we'll try. I would encourage you to corner the speakers after the session, have some of their other questions answered. Let's start, Dr. Martin, in regards to the mediastinal traverse, what's the best way to evaluate the esophagus? Do you need a scope? Do you need contrast? Do you need both? And if you're doing contrast, what method? Fluoroscopy, CT? How do we do this?
So I think that's assuming that your CT has suggested an injury or your exam has suggested an injury. I think the best way to evaluate, if you're not doing it intraoperatively, is a contrast swallow study. And we do a fluoro study followed by an immediate CT scan. And that will usually pick up most of your leaks. If you do one of those separately, just the swallow study has about 15%, 20% miss leak rate. CT has about a 5%. If you combine them, it has about a 99% rate for picking those up.
You use esophagoscopy as well?
Esophagoscopy, the only time I'll use that is if it's intra-op and I'm concerned and trying to make the diagnosis.
And this is water-soluble contrast,
yes.
Correct? Yes. Lots of questions about gastric ulcer. Dr. Cubano, where is he? Way down there. What's giant?
What?
What is giant?
How big?
4 centimeters,
giant,
8 centimeters?
Giant, by definition. There's some papers that talk about 2 centimeter. The majority of the literature talks about 3 centimeter in diameter. That's what's considered to be a giant gastric ulcer.
There are some questions about the Dr. Notrika for coin battery. There you are, coin battery ingestions, which is a kind of a separate topic. And if you could just give a capsule, what do we do with those?
So
golden time for extraction, et cetera.
The button batteries, the 20 millimeter coin cell batteries are a huge problem for us. Most of the damage occurs very early. There's now a published algorithm from AAP, mainly written by ENT surgeons, but it's a pretty reasonable thing to do. The truth is that once the injury happens, trying to avoid an aortoenteric fistula or trying to avoid an erosion into the trachea is not really possible. What's going to happen is going to happen, and there is no great solution for that. I would follow the algorithm only because it helps protect you medically legally. At our hospital, we've had 2 of them, and both resulted in lawsuits. One of them settled, and the other one did not.
Uh-oh. Sheldon, there are a bunch of questions about DDAVP for both aspirin and also Plavix. Can you give us your thoughts on use of that?
I think the data is reasonable with aspirin and DDAVP, and I don't know about Plavix. But so we would use it, especially if the patient was bleeding.
Speak to the audience, not the moderator.
Yes, sir. So we would use it for renal dysfunction of platelets. We would use it for aspirin, and I'm not sure about Plavix.
I've noticed, just in surveying, I see a lot of centers that have protocols for Plavix that include DDAVP. How about the rest of the panelists? Other comments? DDAVP and Plavix?
Yeah, we have a protocol and it includes DDAVP.
Anybody else?
Yeah, we do.
Yeah. We do as well.
Sounds like that's the way to go.
It's one of those things that is relatively cheap, and it might help, but it's not going to hurt.
None of that stuff really works, you know that. There's a lot of praying that goes on when these things happen. Thank you, Sheldon.
Dr. Bernard, question about should pancreatitis or severe pancreatitis be condensed or streamlined into a single service line in a given hospital?
You mean, is the question related to who manages?
Yeah, should it be a little bit of medicine, a little bit of here, a little bit of surgery? I'm talking about the most severe cases.
Yeah, my bias is that severe pancreatitis in the critically ill is best managed by surgical intensivists rather than pulmonary medicine, critical care physicians. That's my bias. But we don't have a protocol for that in our institution. I think the key thing where the rubber meets the road is at the point of intervention. And I think you really benefit from having a surgeon and an interventional radiologist and an endoscopist all together, regardless of who's doing the critical care at that point. But my bias is surgical intensivist.
Dr. Campbell, there's some questions. You covered it in your talk, the Kleihauer-Betke test, but there's still some questions about how you use this. Do you get it on everybody? How do you tailor your treatment based on the KB test?
So the first thing is that when there's an injury to the placenta, there's interaction between the blood from the fetus to the mother. The mother is negative, and she gets exposed to the fetus. There's an immune response that happens. Now, depending on whether or not you're less than 12 weeks pregnant, greater than 12 weeks pregnant, the dosing of Rogaine changes whether or not it's 150 or 300, but you're going to give it if you think there's been disruption of the placenta, and that's usually what happens. So it is basically the mother's immune response to the fetus because she recognizes it as something that shouldn't be there because there's an abruption or disruption of the placental membrane. So that's really what it is in a nutshell. It's fetus being recognized as a foreign body to the mother being negative, the fetus being positive, and this is what happens. And this will reduce the chance of problems in the future.
Dr. Gurney, there are all sorts of questions. You're going to be cornered, I think, after the session. But this one is talking about the most difficult lap chole, benefit of doing an open cholecystectomy versus a subtotal or just leave parts of the gallbladder with the concerns about remnant cholecystitis. How do you sort through that?
Well, I think it depends on your experience. I remember as a, actually the attending is in here, as a junior attending, I was pursuing with a really challenging lap coli, and he walked in and said, "Why are you doing that? I'd be open, you know, 2 hours ago." And because that's, but my experience is laparoscopy. I trained in the era where we didn't do very many lap coli. So it depends on your experience. If you do a lot of open cholecystectomies, and I think early conversion makes sense. I've certainly, as I've gotten more experience, will convert early. And if it's hard, I'll stay out of the danger zone, absolutely, and do a subtotal cholecystectomy. I prefer doing fenestrated and not reconstituting. You know, you lay drains and it drains bile for a couple days and then it goes away. You get an ERCP and you see the cystic duct is obliterated.
Yep.
And so if you leave it open, they're not going to get recurrent cholecystitis. They might have a bile leak that will usually get better with time, and you can do an ERCP and then do a stent, which will help it go down. So I think that, you know, you don't have to do the impossible total cholecystectomy. If it's impossible, don't do it. You're going to hurt the patient. So you know, you have to kind of think about your bailout procedures before you go into the operating room with these.
If it's impossible, don't do it. Sounds like a Yogi Berra-ism.
Yeah.
Andre?
I'll just say that I have never regretted opening up somebody during a lap coli. So she did a really great review of things and with SAGES and all the basic tips. The main thing is, if you do not have the critical view, you must open, and you have to decide early. And I don't see that as a problem.
Well, I think you can do a laparoscopic fenestrated or laparoscopic subtotal, right. But if you don't have the critical view, clip something.
And critical view is essential.
Yeah, so I mean, either you're going to do it laparoscopically if you have the skills to do that, or you're going to open. And sometimes that depends on your patients and your patient. If your patient won't tolerate a long laparoscopic procedure, then just open.
And opening is never a failure.
It's never a failure.
Miguel?
Yeah, and I think she brought another great point, which is, when in doubt, call somebody else. Another set of eyes is always has bailed me out in many of the situations.
But I just want to say one other thing. The 60% of duct injuries occur in easy gallbladders. They occur in easy gallbladders. So I think that the visual heuristics and not let your mind playing tricks on you is really the important thing. So the duct is divided intentionally 60% of the time. It's just not recognized. And in the op note, they'll say critical view of safety obtained, and there's nothing about the gallbladder being difficult. Mm-hmm. So I think being aware of that, being aware of those tricks, is really important to decrease the incidence of duct injury.
Yeah, and I also think, so it's visual heuristics, it's also retraction.
Yeah.
Because if you pull hard enough, you can straighten that common duct out so it looks like the cystic duct. So after getting critical view of safety, whoever's doing the retraction, or if it's you, let go. And then sometimes you'll see, oh, you were actually pulling up the common duct. So I would say both of those.
I really love what you said about that timeout.
Yes.
Right, before you clip. That is really a great thing, so that everybody sees everything. I think it was really a great thing to do.
So you mean, Andre, you're turning to your resident or even the scrub tech and saying, you know, are we on the same page, and do you believe that we do have a critical view?
Well, I think it lets you reorient yourself, too. If you stop and then you look at it again, and sometimes you'll pick up, oh, well, I'm a little lower than I should be. So
maybe it could be an internal timeout. You're saying to yourself, do I have the right thing? Maybe yes.
That internal conversation.
All right, Dr. Martin, partial axial traverse, gunshot wound, the bullet's abutting the aorta. There's a little irregularity on CT in the aortic wall. How do you determine if this is going to turn into a pseudoaneurysm or something you need to worry about?
So depending on what it looked like, the options there would be to get a catheter angiogram and get a better look at it. I think whether you do that or not, then your answer would be to repeat your CT angiogram. You know, it's kind of like a carotid injury. So somewhere in the 7 to 14 day range, see if it's nothing or if it's turning into a pseudoaneurysm.
If it's thoracic, would you ever use transesophageal echo or IVUS?
I wouldn't, but I think that's reasonable depending on your skill set and what's available.
Yeah, and then there's also a question of whether or not there's blast injury. Those things will, if they're sitting right on it, they will erode.
All right. They can, certainly. Dr. Cubano, this was a question. Gram patch for gastric ulcers? Sort of exclamation mark, question mark, question mark. So if you've got a case in someone who with a perforated, let's say it's 2.5-3 centimeter ulcer, but it's in the greater curve, the patient's moderately sick but not dying, should you gram patch those or really resect them?
Where's the location? I'm sorry.
Greater curve, easy place.
Well, I think that was part of the essence of my talk. I think that the new trend is to actually do a gastrectomy on those cases. Gram patch, to tell you the truth, at this stage would be somebody in your judgment that is so unstable that will not be able to tolerate. When I talked about also, there's if you look at the algorithm that I presented, one of the options is wedge. The question is, how big is that ulcer and how big is the defect if you really wedge that lesion? So I would still think that resection would be what my option, you know, the best option at this stage.
So Bob, on that, once you get above 2 centimeters, certainly 3 centimeters, a patch is very likely to fail.
Yep.
Correct. Agreed. That's the other.
Dr. Natrika, question about the care of pediatric patients at a trauma center with these kinds of things. Should they be transferred to tertiary centers?
It really depends on what the availability is at your hospital. So a lot of times the ENT surgeons at peripheral hospitals can do this. And if they can take, was it about button batteries or was it about caustic?
No, it was caustic ingestion.
Yeah, I'm sorry. So the truth is that you are much better off transferring that patient because you've got time. Time is on your side. definitely transfer to a place that has experience if that's an option.
Dr. Tepperman, use of K-Centra or prothrombin complex concentrate routinely for NOAC reversals. Good idea, bad idea?
So I think, so routinely, no. So it, like I said in the talk, the half-lives of these agents are short, and as we've been seeing, so I've never used it. I've never used any reversal agent. The drug just goes away and the patient either stops bleeding or I stop the bleeding. So only if you're pushed and you think that the bleeding is because of the NOAC, then yes, the PCC, because you're not probably not going to have the other stuff. I dare use a MAB or and Dexanet.
Yeah, I mean, that's the big debate now, right? And the data's not great. The CHEST guidelines, though, now are recommending Andexa, which is, you know, like you said, $29,000 with very little data. The Anexa-4 study just came out, and it's horrible. But they're recommending it because it's an FDA-approved drug, and PCC isn't for that indication. So a lot of people are stuck in that, you know, what do you do? There's reasonable data. PCC is at least just as good as it. Mm-hmm. It's cheaper. But now you have guidelines that are recommending, you know, this $30,000 drug that hasn't been shown to decrease bleeding.
Right.
It's been shown to change one lab value.
Dr. Bernard, there's some questions here about worrying about early infection of pancreatic necrosis, the retroperitoneum. Years ago, we used to sample these things. Where do we stand with that now?
Yeah, that's a great question. I don't routinely tap, and I think most people don't routinely aspirate and look for infection. Your threshold to start antimicrobials should be pretty high. You're going to want the pancreas to look like it is frankly infected. Air is pretty helpful. But even when you get to that point, you're going to need to involve your interventionalist because in addition to starting antimicrobials, it's time to drain. But that's going to be pretty far into it. So I don't tap. Wait a long time. Try to avoid using antimicrobials. Mm-hmm. The point at which you're thinking you might want to stick a drain in there and see if it's infected is probably a time to be talking to your interventionalist about how we're going to get all that goo out of there, because it's just as likely the goo is inflaming them, the necrotic liquefied pancreas, as it is any bacteria in there. Kind of like what Dr. Kaplan was talking about this morning.
Last question, Dr.
Time out. Your time is up. Your microphone is now off.